for this day, gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, we burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, fill our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, almighty. Thank you. for this day, gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, we burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we wanna see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our prayer. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, fill our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river. Thank you. for this day. Gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire. We burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we wanna see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our prayer. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, fill our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, almighty.
Greetings, everyone. My name is Brady Witten, and I welcome you to worship here at First United Methodist Church in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Welcome those of you who are here in person, those of you who are joining us at home. So today, as we worship, as we pray together, as we sing great hymns of the faith together, as we hear the scripture read, we are going to explore a very difficult parable of Jesus's and see what it tells us about the way to salvation. Will you join me in prayer? Faithful God, we give you thanks that in Jesus Christ you have entrusted us with the richness of your glory and the treasure of your grace. Lord, make us faithful stewards of your good gifts, that we may show your love to this world. And Lord, in this time of worship, we ask that you would pour your Holy Spirit out upon us. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
please remain standing and join me as we affirm our faith together as printed in your bulletin. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and who is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and to serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen. Be seated. Shared life together here today as the body of Christ. These beautiful flowers are given to the glory of God in memory of Bobby Carver by his family. And our guest musicians today are provided in memory of Blake Unglesby by Lewis and Gail Unglesby. And so now let us prepare our hearts for prayer. O God of grace and loving kindness, Lord of mercy, forgiveness, and compassion, you are forever faithful and true, always present and near, always working for the good on our behalf to accomplish in us that which we cannot accomplish for ourselves. Always healing, companioning, and restoring us to newness of life. It is we who turn away from you and your grace to wander among weed and thorn. But in your merciful, self-giving, and compassionate nature, you come to us. You enlighten our minds and warm our hearts, calling us to repent of our sin and to return to you, to discern the path of grace that leads to abundant life, and a generous spirit overflowing with love for all. And Lord, in our heartfelt sorrow for the death, for the suffering and violence that we see within our community, guide us and lead us and help us become vessels of your peace in the world. Help us faithfully follow the leading and guidance of that spirit of your love. For you have blessed us with the ability to choose and to bless. Grant that we choose wisely in all that we do, say, and accomplish. Grant that we become blessings who bless and comfort others, so that we may reflect the divine image you have imprinted upon our souls. Lord of mystery and mercy and wonder, God of the incarnation and the resurrection, create in us clean and pure hearts, and place in each of us a new and right spirit. As we pray the prayer Jesus taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. And on this next hymn that we're singing together, on the last verse, we invite all of our beautiful children to come down to the front for a sermon, children's sermon with Miss Joy, I believe. And then also those of you who are watching us from home, gather around for this very special time of sharing and prayer together.
got hugs, you guys. It was so amazing. Okay, so we're going to learn about stewards today. Do y'all know what a steward is? I didn't either. I had to look it up. So a steward is someone who takes care of something. Usually they take care of something for someone else, but not always. Sometimes you can take care of your own things, but we always have to be mindful of where those things come from. So I want to tell y'all a story about when I was asked to be a steward. Okay, y'all ready? So I came home, I was in elementary school. I came home from school one day and immediately went outside to play because it was a beautiful day. But as the sun began to set, I knew I needed to go inside. So I went inside and immediately, you know what I smelled cooking? Baking. Cookies, that's right.
I knew it.
And so the cookie story is not in the Bible, but it's close. Steward, yes, it is. Reverend Brady's going to talk about a manager or a steward. So I went inside and, oh, it smelled so good. Chocolate chip cookies in the oven.
Chocolate chip cookies are my favorite.
Favorite of all. So my mom was taking them out of the oven and they were nice and chewy and, oh, they looked delicious. And I said, Mom, are those for us? Yes.
Are they soft?
They were soft in the middle, crunchy on the outside. It was amazing. So she said, yes, Joy, you can have some cookies, but you have to wait until after dinner. I said, okay, I can do that. And she said, I need you to help me with something before I serve dinner. She said, you know, Miss Marcus has been sick. That's the lady next door. Mrs. Marcus has been sick. I need you to take her some of these cookies. They'll help her to feel better. And I said, I can do that. So she gave me two cookies. And I was to bring them to Miss Marcus. Well, I start across the way to Mrs. Marcus's house, and I'm looking at these warm, nice, soft cookies with crunchy on the edge. And I just went, Mrs. Marcus only needs one of those cookies. And so I ate one. It's a real story. I ate one of the cookies. And so I brought Mrs. Marcus the cookie. Never got found out, okay? Until the next day, I come home from school, and I hear my mom on the phone with Mrs. Marcus. And Mrs. Marcus says, Jane, thank you so much for my cookie. And my mom said, cookies. Joy was supposed to bring you two cookies. See, I was not a good steward. I did not take care of what was given to me. So my mom said, Joy, did you eat one of those cookies? And I said, oh, I ate it, Mother. I ate it. I'm so sorry. Please forgive me. She said, I forgive you. And she took me in her arms and she hugged me real big. But she said, there are consequences to not obeying what I ask you to do with those cookies. Hang on just a second. She said, no dessert for a week. No sweets, no candy, no cookie, no cake, no pie, no nothing for a week. Nope, I didn't do any more sneaking. No more sneaking. I did not do any more sneaking. And the next day she made my favorite, which was lemon pie. And I couldn't have any. I think she may have done it on purpose to teach me a lesson. So to be a steward is to take care of something for someone else. If I had been a good steward, I would have taken both of those cookies and shared them with Mrs. Marcus, but I chose not to be, and so I ate one of them. Yes. No candy or sweets?
On school days.
On school days. Well, sometimes they make us a little hyper, you know? That's right. Okay, so we're gonna pray and ask God to help us be good stewards. Dear Heavenly Father, please help me to be a good steward of the things that you give me, whether that's cookies or money or time or talent.
Okay.
Help me to be a good steward and take care of the things that you've given me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Y'all go back to your seat.
Thank you, Joy. Thank you. So as the children return to their seats, I want to invite you to stand. And this is where we share the peace of Christ with one another. But I liked what Patty had you do last week. I lost you already. Share the peace. those things said, I'll invite our ushers to come forward as we take up our offering. And as they come, will you bow your heads with me in prayer? Let us pray. Lord God, Jesus teaches that no one can serve two masters. We cannot serve both God and wealth. We cannot serve the kingdom of God and the kingdom of this world. And so, Lord, we entrust our treasures to you, you who have provided so abundantly for us. And Lord, we ask your blessing upon these offerings, that they may be used for your kingdom work, your kingdom cause on this earth, spreading the great news of your love and grace, which are available in Jesus the Christ. And we pray these things in his precious name. Amen.
Please remain standing for the gospel lesson and join me in the prayer for illumination, which is printed in your bulletin. Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you have for us today. Amen. A reading from the 16th chapter of Luke. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "There was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was squandering his property. So he summoned him and said to him, 'What is this that I hear about you?
Give me an accounting of your management because you cannot be my manager any longer. Then the manager said to himself, what will I do now that my master is taking the position away from me? I am not strong enough to dig, and I am ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do so that when I am dismissed as manager, people may welcome me into their homes. So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, how much do you owe my master? He answered, 100 jugs of olive oil. He said to him, take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 50. Then he asked another, and how much do you owe? He replied, 100 containers of wheat. He said to him, take your bill and make it 80. And his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into the eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in a very little is faithful also in much, and whoever is dishonest in a very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful with the dishonest wealth, who will entrust to you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful with what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No slave can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Peggy. Peggy, while I've got you up here, do you want to come and try to explain this parable for us? So, I have to tell you all kind of a funny. I had asked Patty to preach this Sunday months ago because I wanted y'all to have a chance to hear from her, and it just seemed like a good time for a break. And so she was supposed to preach on this parable. And when she looked ahead, she said, I can't believe that you're having me preach on that parable. What does it, I mean, it's just so confusing. Then something came up. And so I was supposed to preach on the lost sheep and the lost coin. And then something came up and we had to swap. And so I think it's called poetic justice or something like that, right? So we have this parable that is often called the parable of the unjust steward. Sometimes it's called the parable of the shrewd manager. It has lots of different names. It is a parable that preachers and Bible teachers try to avoid like the plague because we just sort of wonder, what is this about? What is Jesus trying to tell us here? And I actually want to take just a moment and talk about, so the parable ends in about verse 8, okay? It ends with, the master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. Then we have several sort of Jesus sayings, things like no one can serve two masters and all that kind of stuff. But the thing that interests me is, and you see the translators struggling with this parable that's before it, when they say things like this, if you have not been faithful with the dishonest wealth, who will entrust you true riches? And those kinds of things. So what is dishonest wealth? The word that's translated there is actually the word mammon, which some of you may be familiar with. And all that mammon is, it's the stuff of the world. And so what Jesus is saying is if you can't be trusted with the stuff of the world, then how can you be trusted with other things? But it just shows me the struggle here. I'm trying to point out that the translators translated as dishonest wealth because the same exact word is used in the very last expression and they just use wealth. So you can see that even the translators are trying to struggle to make sense out of this parable. So on the surface, the parable is about a manager who cheats his master and is then praised for being a liar and a thief. Is that what y'all got out of it? I mean, that's what the parable's about. And as if that's not enough, Luke then goes on to tell us that Jesus says that we should emulate this guy. We should be like this guy. Now, come on. That can't be what Jesus is trying to tell us here, right? I mean, so what's going on? And we're going to dig in a little bit and figure out maybe what's happening here. What is Jesus trying to teach us in this parable? And remember, parables are trying to teach us something about the nature of God. We're supposed to understand something about God and something about life in God's kingdom. So what is Jesus trying to tell us? And I am going to be honest with you, this is like a Bible nerd sermon, so I'm going to like really dig into the scripture here. So I'm going to ask y'all, you got to put on your thinking caps, and I need your focus. Okay, just give me your focus. I know that can be difficult. To give you something to listen for, I want to offer a few thoughts. This sermon is for those who struggle to accept forgiveness and who maybe question their place with God. That's one thing it's about. This sermon is also for those who struggle to extend forgiveness and maybe question other people's place with God. And as I mentioned, it's also for Bible nerds and for people who like to try to solve problems, because it's the way my brain works. Okay, so as always, when we're approaching one of Jesus's parables, it is best if we try to understand some of the larger context. What is going on around this parable? And one of the things that becomes abundantly clear when we read through the New Testament is that Jesus had opposition. Y'all aware of that? There were people all throughout the New Testament who did not like what Jesus was doing, and they did not like what Jesus was teaching. And the way this opposition often played out is Jesus comes into a situation and he extends forgiveness, or he extends healing, or he extends some act of mercy towards somebody, and these opponents like jump up and say to him, "You can't do that, it's against the rules." And I love Jesus every single time. Jesus says, "Oh yeah? Watch me." And he heals people, and he forgives people. And these opponents are constantly coming up at him and saying, "But Jesus, you're breaking the Sabbath laws by doing that." And Jesus says, "Okay." And they say, "Jesus, you don't have, only God alone has the power to forgive sin." And he says, "Okay." And so these opponents of Jesus, as we find throughout the Hebrew Scriptures, and I would describe them this way. They were people who really believed that they had an inside track to God. They were sort of God's chosen people. They were the good people. And they had an understanding about who was in and who was out when it came to the things of God. So when we encounter these folks in the New Testament, these are some of the names that are given to them. We read about the Pharisees. We read about the scribes. Some describe them as experts in the law. They understood the rules of religion, but often they seem to miss the heart and the spirit of the rules. In Patty's sermon last week, which if you didn't get to hear it, I would encourage you to go listen to it, she called these people gatekeepers. They kind of felt like it was their job to be the gatekeepers. In Luke 18:9, Jesus describes these opponents this way. Listen up. They were people who trusted in themselves that they were righteous, and they regarded others with contempt. So I'm going to say that again. They trusted in who? Themselves, that they were righteous. And because they thought they were pretty good, they looked down with contempt on other people, right? So these are Jesus' opponents. And Jesus does all kinds of things to express his disagreement with these opponents. He forgives, he heals, he does the things that he was going to do anyway, despite their opposition. He also tells stories about a God of mercy and a God of grace. And in this section of Luke, we encounter a number of these stories. One of the stories we hear is a story about a feast, where Jesus says, "When you have a feast, don't invite your rich friends and neighbors and powerful people. Invite the poor, invite the lame, invite the orphans and widows." He's saying invite people who are disenfranchised and marginalized, and he's giving us a picture of the kingdom of God. We also hear stories like the parable of the lost sheep and the lost coin, which remind us that God goes to extreme lengths to go out and find those who are separated from him, and that when they are welcomed home, when they come back, the angels in heaven celebrate, right? Another parable that we didn't read, the lectionary didn't assign this one this year, is a parable, the parable known as the Great Banquet, where a master again throws the doors open to a wedding feast and he invites everyone who can. Again, a picture of the kingdom of God. And the parable just before the one that we just read, just before the parable of the dishonest manager, is the parable of the prodigal son. Right? Again, what's that story about? A father who welcomes his son home with great mercy, right? So these are all these stories, and again, following the prodigal son is this parable that we read today, the parable of the dishonest manager. And what I want to suggest, and what I'm going to try to show you, is that this, too, is a parable of God's grace and God's mercy. It's pretty obvious, isn't it? Well, maybe not. So let me see if I can get us there. Okay. So we start with a rich man or a master who leaves his business in the hands of a manager. And this is a common setup for Jesus' story, some wealthy person who's left somebody in charge of their land or in charge of their property. Now, we already clearly see that we have two main characters in this story. Who are the two main characters? The master. I hear somebody saying the master. And who else? The manager. Okay, so we got two people here. And this is the problem with Bible translations, and Patty pointed this out last week. In most of our Bibles, if you look at the top of this section, it's going to say something like the parable of the unjust manager, the parable of the wise, or the shrewd steward, something like that. And immediately our focus is on who? Our focus is on the manager. But what if that's not the right focus? I mean, Jesus did not stand up and say, the parable of the shrewd manager. It's not what he said. He said, let me tell you a story. Okay? And so what if focusing on the manager is the wrong thing? What if we instead are supposed to focus on the master? What happens? What changes? So let's try that. So we have a rich man who leaves his business in the hands of his manager, and the master in the story discovers that his manager has been squandering his property. And so he calls him in to give him an account of his management, Jesus says. Now, I got to point out, here's a Bible nerd thing. The word squander his property, that's also used in the parable of the prodigal son. So already, wait, there's some connections here, right? So already we learned something important about the master. So in his book, Jesus Through Middle Eastern Eyes, Kenneth Bailey points out that legally, the master had several options. There were several things he could have done with this dishonest manager. One of the things he could have done is he could have had him thrown in jail. The second thing he could have done was he could have sold him and his family into slavery in order to recoup the money that he had lost. Okay? This was allowed, and the people of Jesus' day would have known this. So again, could have thrown the guy in jail, could have sold him and his whole family into slavery and got the money for it, but the master does neither of those things. All the master does is what? Let the guy go. He just says, look, you can't be my manager anymore. And so what is it that we learn about the master? The master is what? Gracious and merciful and kind. So when I read this week, it reminded me, some of you will know this part of the Mary and Joseph story, that when Joseph found out that Mary was pregnant out of wedlock. Does everybody know what Joseph's legal right was? He could have had her stoned to death. She had committed adultery. But the Bible tells us he was a righteous man, and he did what? He dismissed her quietly. And I kind of think we see that from the master here. He could have done terrible things to this guy, but instead he does what? He dismisses him quietly. And so we see, again, the master is what? Gracious and merciful. Right? And it is this mercy that sets up the whole rest of the story. So we got to get this point. You with me with this master is merciful thing? You with me? All right, remember I said focus? Put on your thinking caps. So it is in response to the master's mercy that the manager cooks up this scheme. Okay? And the scheme is this. The manager is concerned about his future well-being. He's like, look, when I don't work for the master anymore, what am I going to do? How am I going to care for myself? And he says, I know what I'll do. He says, I will ingratiate myself to my neighbors. And here's the way I picture this going down. He said to himself, I'm going to call my neighbors in and I'm going to say, I will do a service for you. And in return, one day, I will call you to do a service for me. Y'all know that. That was a bad Godfather, right? So he's trying to like make a deal with his neighbors so that later on they'll take care of him, right? Now, there are a bunch of things we need to notice about this deal-making between the manager and these debtors, right? The first thing is this. The debtors assume that the manager is still working for the master. Okay? And I'm going to tell you how we know that in a couple of ways. The debtors, the people who owe the master, assume that the manager is still working for him. Here's how we know that. First of all, the guy still has the books. Probably what he should have done after he'd met with the master and the master said, you can no longer be my manager, he's supposed to go home, get the books, bring them to the master, and turn them in, right? I'm not managing this stuff anymore. But this is when he hatches his scheme, and he's still got the books. And we know that because when he sits down with the debtors, they open up the books and they change them. So he's got them. The other way we know this is that when he summons the debtors, read the parable, he calls them to him. Now, if they did not think that he was still working for the master, what do you think they'd have done? They've blown him off. I don't owe you a thing. You just got fired. But so they come to this meeting with the manager thinking they are sitting down with the master's representative. One more way we know this. He has them, did you notice it in the scripture? He has them change the ledger in their own handwriting. Now, if they thought that he was doing something illegal, would they have put their handwriting in that book? Lawyers out there, would they have put their handwriting in that book? No, they think this is legit, right? So when the guy says, hey, how much do you owe my master? And he says, you know, 100 jugs of oil, and he says, cut it in half, write it in the book. They think, this is amazing. The manager, on behalf of the master, is forgiving my debt. You with me? And it's important we also know that the amount of money that was forgiven was a large amount of money. Somewhere around half a year's wages that they've been forgiven, okay? So let me ask you, when the debtors leave that meeting with the person that they think is the master's representative and they go back to their homes, they go back to their neighbors, what do they do? What do they do? What would you do if your banker sent you an email and said, hey, I just forgave half of your mortgage, right? What do? They celebrate. They tell everybody in their home. They probably tell their next door neighbors. Then and the buzz starts to go around the village. Oh my gosh, the master is forgiving us. The master is generous. The master is good, right? They start having hats and t-shirts made that say, the master is my homeboy, right? They're just like, woohoo. And then word gets back to the master. And what he hears is, hey, everybody in town is celebrating how generous you are. And this is where we really hit the game changer in the story. Now, let's remember what the master's options are here. He could have thrown this manager in jail, right? He could have sold this guy and his whole family into slavery and recouped his money that way. That was an option. And by the way, now he really has a reason to do that. Whatever it was before, now he's really got a reason. He also could have gone into the village and into the middle of the party and the celebration and told everybody, hey, that guy lied. I haven't forgiven you anything. Pay it all. But that's not how the story ends, is it? So it turns out that the manager was right about the master. The master is really merciful and really generous. And again, not only does the master not have the guy thrown in jail, he actually pats him on the back and says, good job, good job. So Kenneth Bailey goes on to say this. He's the guy who wrote the book, Jesus Through Middle Eastern Eyes. The manager is smart enough to know that his only hope is to put his entire trust in the unqualified mercy of his generous master. He's in trouble, and he knows the only way out of this is I'm going to have to trust that my master really is as merciful and generous as he thinks he is. And Bailey goes on to say his gamble pays off. The master pays the price for the steward's salvation. I'm going to say that again. The manager is smart enough to know that his only hope is to put his entire trust in the unqualified mercy of his generous master. And his gamble pays off. The master pays the price for the steward's salvation. Y'all get it? Get the picture? So By the way, this is what Jesus wants us to emulate, this unbelievable and audacious trust in the fact that our master is generous and merciful. That's what we're supposed to copy, not the guy's thieving and conning. It's not what we're emulating. You with me? So that is the parable of the dishonest manager told as a parable of grace. What do y'all think? What do y'all think? I love it, to tell you the truth. Now, I always say, somebody's clapping. So listen, I always consider it a compliment when people go home and say, we argued about your sermon over lunch, or we argued about it. So if this creates some arguments amongst you or some debate among you, good, I've done my job. But here's some things I want to point out. It is amazing what happens when we shift our focus on the characters in these stories, right? When we're focused on the dishonest manager, we don't know what to make of the story. But when we focus on the merciful and generous master, now we got something. Now we got something. The other thing I'll tell you is this. When we read the parable that way, there are likely two reactions going on. I've taught Bible studies long enough to know. There are two reactions. Some of you are going, praise God and thank God for the merciful master. And some of you are saying, that is not fair. And that's how I know now we got a Jesus parable. Because that's people's reactions to a lot of his parables. Now, the other thing I want to throw in there is this while you're having your lunch conversations. There's some connection, and I don't have time to chase it. There's some connection between the fact that this dishonest manager is sort of banking on his master's mercy, and he also extends what to the people around him? Mercy. There's something there, but we'll chase that one another time. So I want to pause here, and I want to talk to two people who might be hearing this right now. First, I want to talk to those who maybe struggle to receive forgiveness and who wonder about their place with God. And second, I want to talk to those of you who might struggle to extend forgiveness to others and find yourself wondering about other people's place with God. So first, to those of you who wonder if you have a place with God, the first thing I want you to know is, I've been there. I've been there. And I think a lot of people in this room have been. One of my fears about this particular job that I have is that I stand up here in front of you with a robe on, and everybody goes, oh, it's Reverend Brady, and my beautiful wife and cooperative son sit in the front pew. And everybody thinks, look how good Brady's life is, and look how good Brady is. And I want you to know, here's my favorite way of saying this. Let's just tell you, I ain't perfect, okay? And in my past, I have been far, far, far from perfect. I was that guy in the prodigal son story who took his father's inheritance and went to a faraway land and squandered it. But I am so grateful for a gracious God who, when the time came and I thought, can I return home? Can I go back to my father? That my father threw his arms open and welcomed me. So if you're a person who says, I wonder, can God forgive me and accept me? I want you to know, I understand where you're coming from, and I want you to know that the answer to your question is yes, yes. See, here's the bottom line about the gospel. The gospel is not about how good we are. The gospel is about how good God is. And it's why I think this parable can be so powerful. If we shift our attention off of ourselves and off of our failings and off of this manager's messing everything up and put our focus on the master who is merciful and generous, right? Stop focusing on yourself and your inability to get it right. It's not what it's about. And turn your focus instead to the mercy and the grace of God. Follow Jesus. Trust in Jesus. Immerse yourself in grace. It will change you. And I'll also tell you this, and what you'll find is, as that grace transforms you, you will start following the rules. Not because they're written down on a piece of paper, but because God's Spirit is living inside of you. So to those who find themselves maybe struggling to forgive other people, maybe some... There's some rule keepers in here and some gatekeepers in here. So I have long said that I feel badly for the Pharisees in the Bible. I really do believe they are just trying to be good religious people. They're trying to do what their grandma and their mom told them is the right thing to do. And they've kind of gotten trapped in this world of rules. But here's the thing. The gospel is not about a set of rules. The gospel is not about getting certain things right and getting certain things wrong. If that's what you were taught incorrectly. Listen to me. The gospel is God's rescue plan for those of us who can't get it right. Anybody know who that is? It's all of us. It's God's rescue plan for you and me. It's not about rules. It's not about keeping ourselves straight. Now, I do want to say again, when we live in this gracious relationship with God, we will begin to do right things. It's just for a very different reason, right? We have a place with God, not because of who we are, not because of what we do, but because of who God is. And if we will get our focus off of ourselves, off of I got this wrong or I got that wrong, or I got this right and I got that right, if we'll take it off of ourselves and put it instead on our gracious and generous Master, then we've got something. So I am sold on this interpretation of this parable. Now, of course, it does take that shift, right? Just don't focus on the manager. Let's focus on the Master. So do me a favor, please. Let's never, ever again call this the parable of the dishonest manager, okay? From now on, it's the parable of the merciful and generous Master. You with me? Because in the end, that is what the gospel is all about. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Will you pray with me? Lord God, there are all kinds of people in this room. There are people who have really messed up life. Hurt people, hurt themselves. And Lord, there are people in this room who have done pretty well. They're disciplined. They're rule followers. Lord, help us all to see that we are all equally in need of your grace. And Lord, for those who wonder if they have a place with you, I just ask that you touch them with your presence and your grace. Lord, for those who think they don't need you, touch them with your presence and your grace. Lord, help us to follow your Son, to trust him, and to immerse ourselves in life with him, that we may be transformed and the world with us. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. So it's always a privilege to be able to extend the invitation to anyone here who's looking for a church home to consider making First Methodist that church home. We have a gathering that we call Believe and Belong. And if you come in person, we actually share a meal together. We talk about what does it mean to believe in Jesus? What does it mean to belong to a community of faith? It's a rich and great conversation. So if you're a Christian person who's looking for a church, we'd love to have you. The upcoming dates for Believe and Belong are in your bulletin. I think it's the 6th and the 9th of October. Or if you're a person who maybe is feeling a little tug on your heart to become a Christian and to begin to follow Jesus, I also would invite you to come to that for a really rich and great discussion. Also want to make sure you know we have a resource table back through this door to the left, and there's some great materials on there, some teachings on the basics of Christianity, the basics of the Bible, and basics of United Methodism. If that's anything that interests you, we invite you to take those resources as you go this morning. And now I invite you to stand as we sing our closing hymn. Thank you.